necessarily those of Beasley Broadcast Group, this station, its staff, other advertisers, or agencies.
Welcome to Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner on Love 860 WAEC, Atlanta's inspirational talk radio. Lisa is a writer, producer, and innovative communicator with more than 20 years of experience. Join us as we connect you with inspiring experts and entrepreneurs from all walks of life. Your comments and questions are welcome during the broadcast. Call us live on the air at 404-355-8699. That's 404-355-8699. Now, here's Lisa Faulkner.
Hello, everybody. And thanks for joining me for another week of Game Changers with me, Lisa Faulkner. Boy, am I excited today. I'm just going to calm down because y'all know when I get excited, I stutter, I mess up words, I just run on and run on. But I'm excited today, and I think that you're going to be excited as well. We're going to have a great show. We have a great show on tap for you. Black Lives Matter. Is it liberating or separating? We're going to talk about it today. Call in. You can talk about it as well. But, you know, I have to take some time just to thank you for all of your continued support. I couldn't do it without you. Guys, you know where to find me, don't you? Connect with me on Facebook at Lisa M. Faulkner, on LinkedIn, Lisa Faulkner, Twitter at Pinstar Lisa, Instagram and Pinterest, Pinstar Lisa as well. I will continue to check your comments there and continue to connect with you. I gain great new friends every week, and I love it. Guys, if you want to know in advance who's coming on to the show, like one of my guests just asked me, who's on next week? Who's up next? How do I know? How do I keep up with all of this? You read the newsletters. I read the newsletters. I hope you do. Go to pinstar.org and check them out on the media page. Get signed up for them, and they'll come right to your inbox every week that we produce them anyway. Guys, Game Changers is live, and so are you. When you call 404-355-8699 or 866-923-2860. Guess what? I went rogue today. No notes. You know, I'm a note taker, sometimes by fault. I mean, I'm just glued to my notes. I love preparation, research, but no notes today except for the newsletter, and that's what I'm going to tell you a little bit about our guests from, and then we're just going to get started here. One guest in the building, in the studio with me, is Major Tonya Dedrick. She's a 27-year veteran of the DeKalb County Police Department. She holds the rank of major and is currently commander of DeKalb County's East Precinct, located in Lithonia, Georgia. During her tenure, her assignments and positions include assistant chief, chief of staff, academy director, commander, assistant director, and detective in various divisions and units within the police department. Just told you a little bit about her just so that you know she's well equipped. She is definitely a game changer, and without further ado, I will say welcome to Game Changers, Major Dedrick.
Thank you so very much. It is my pleasure to be here.
Well, it's my sincere pleasure to have you. Guys, we're going to do the show a little bit differently today. I know that I spend most segments or one segment with one guest ordinarily, but I'm going to get all of our guests on the mic here so that we can all join in our roundtable discussion today. I think you'll be very interested in hearing about our next guest as well. He's an attorney for 22 years now and a graduate of Emory Law School. Esquire Winfrey, I call him, has worked for the U.S. Army JAG Corps and taught law school at John Marshall Law School in Atlanta as an instructor of criminal procedure, criminal trial advocacy, and legal research in writing. Esquire Winfrey has enhanced students' lives and the people that he defends on a daily basis. Welcome to Game Changers, Esquire Winfrey.
Thank you for having me. I am honored to be here
and happy
to participate
pleasure.
In this program.
Oh, good to have you. Good to have you. Now, guys, we've got one among us that's just like us as well. He walks alongside these great people just like you and I do, and he's got an opinion just like you and I do. So I'm most honored to have him in the building. He's a retired master sergeant. We call him Robert Mullins or Mr. Mullins. I call him originally from Philadelphia. Pennsylvania, now residing in College Park, Georgia. All these great Georgia residents. residents. He served his country honorably during the Vietnam War and other military assignments, worked in corporate America as well with Dobbs International Services, and he is now retired. But I don't know, maybe they should retire that word retired, because I hear this gentleman gets around assisting himself and others like himself. Welcome to Game Changers, Mr. Mullins.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
Woo! We got a full house. Y'all feel it? I also got to my left my special, special cohort, my special, special God servant, my special, special God sister, godmother, supporter of the show. What do you call her? I call her so many things. Thanks for being here today, Dr. Greathouse. I know you said you didn't want to be on the show, you didn't want to talk on the show, but I have to acknowledge you.
Thank you, Lisa.
And thank you for bringing all these fine people our way for today's show.
Thank you, Lisa. My pleasure, Lisa.
Y'all hear her echo in the background? I don't know, guys. Let's get started. Anyway, let's start with the major. Major, I mean, you can hardly not turn on the television without hearing about Black crime. You can hardly not turn on the television without hearing about police against Blacks in crime together. Atlanta hasn't been hit with an onslaught of these crimes between police and minorities, Blacks in particular, but around the country. Just what is your take on it now? What is your take on it from a authoritative position, a police woman's position?
Well, unfortunately, it seems like the media is driving a lot of maybe some of the tension as it relates to Black Lives Matter. Let's start there.
Okay.
All lives matter.
Amen.
And I think we need to really focus on all lives, including lives of police officers, and that we find a way to effectively communicate with one another, talk to each other, and not at each other. Right now, we're talking at each other. All of the tensions and stress that we see in our media, and it's driving that. Whereas if you really think about law enforcement, and a lot of my bio had to do with recruiting, I just remember sitting in a position and these officers that are trying to get positions in law enforcement, which is to be seen as an honorable profession. Not everyone can be a police officer. And most of those interviews are about helping and protecting, doing those things that they take an oath to do. So now I think it's important that the community, everyone, see police as human beings.
Wow.
When I go home, I am a human just like you. I'm a wife. I'm a mother. I'm a sister, a daughter.
Yes.
And so my life matter as well. Black lives, all lives matter. So I think it starts there, and I think that's where we have the dialogue and a healthy discussion as it relates. And let's now see this as an opportunity for us to correct some things. Instead of blaming us against them, that word against, it shouldn't be. That's contentious in and of itself.
It is.
And I think we need to change it. So it starts probably right here in dialogue such as this, and us working together to figure out an effective solution.
Well, you know, I have to sit on the other side of this now, Major. You say all lives matter. They do. But this slogan, it didn't rise up out of nowhere. It's not a slogan that we just created. It kind of came as a result of everything that's happening in the Black community. And you still don't garner it any weight. You still don't think it's a suitable slogan, if you will.
Well, I think that it causes a lot of the contention that we see that is really driving some of this, because I think we need to actually sit in from the standpoint of law enforcement. If our society, communities think that police officers are just out here killing Black people just because, that's a huge problem in and of itself.
Got it.
And that is the problem that I think needs to be really, really addressed when I look at what law enforcement we really do. And if I could, I just kind of would quickly like to kind of give you, and we did this before in a panel. We've got a lot of people now that are going and sitting and being part of forums and trying to kind of put themselves in law enforcement shoes for a second. But sometimes I think we lose sight of how all of these things can easily turn bad.
Yes.
Equally. So if I had to just quickly, and I have not forgotten, even though I'm in a leadership role, what it's like to be that officer answering that call for service. But something as simple as, if we can just imagine real quickly, it's a Tuesday night, I'm riding in my patrol car and I see your taillights are out. And all I'm going to do in my mind is stop you and say, Miss Faulkner, your taillights are out. That's my plan, to give you a verbal warning, not a ticket, just a verbal warning.
Got it.
Boom. What I don't know is that you have an outstanding warrant for you for mm-hmm. probation violation or whatever the case may be. So what do? The blue lights come on and you take off running.
Mm.
Then what do?
Wow, I'm running. You got to chase me.
I'm going to chase you, right? Mm-hmm. We understand that. So mm-hmm. I'm chasing you, and I've got 20 extra pounds around my waist, too, mm-hmm. needless to say.
Yes.
But I'm chasing you, and at some point, you've got a made-up mind. You're not going back to jail.
Mm.
You're not going back to jail. And then a fight, you know, at some point. My ultimate goal is to take you into custody.
Mm-hmm.
That's all. But you've made up your mind. You're tired of running now. Now we're in an altercation.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are. Around my waist, I have several things that if you get a hold of it, I'm going to have a real bad day.
Mm-hmm.
So that's from my OC spray, my Aspaton, my handcuffs, everything around my waist. And we're struggling. All I want to do is effect an arrest. This started with what?
Mm.
Tail lights out.
Wow.
Now, before you know it here, we're fighting.
I think that's the way of a lot of
And that's exact, and mm-hmm. that happens probably every day. I could say every day that scenario.
They
that
escalate
just that fast.
The now, gentleman that we saw leaving, fleeing from the police, and shot down in the back. It escalated. He was being that was a minor stop
but,
as well.
But even with that being said, to play that completely out real quickly.
Yep.
So now after that, I'm trying to effect arrest with you, but I'm also trying to protect all these things because again, I've not seen a weapon on you or
mm-hmm.
anything. But we're here, and I'm at that point to where again my life mattered too. So now it gets to the point where I feel like I have no other choice, and I'm the only one that will be able to articulate what level of force I need.
Mm-hmm.
I end up shooting you. You know what the news mm-hmm. story is going to be mm-hmm. tomorrow? Police officer shoots an unarmed woman.
Yes.
Well, what happens, let's back up. The unarmed woman that we just talked about committed some charge that led her on probation. The officer had nothing to do with that. That person violated that probation the officer had nothing to do with that.
Mm-hmm.
The person chose to run. The officer had nothing to do with that. And then that person chose to fight or resist that arrest. The officer had nothing to do with that. The officer was simply trying to tell you your tail lights were out.
Mm.
We lose sight of all of that. We rush to judgment.
Wow.
And then on the morning news is officer shot an unarmed person.
Yes,
and then
yes,
here we
yes.
are. And so at some point, we need to work together to figure out that officer did not wake up to kind of go out here and take a life.
This is interesting, Major. This is interesting. Gentlemen, you all have got to weigh in on this. I hear the Major saying a couple of things. I hear her saying, there's a small minority of police out there who are probably targeting people the way most of society thinks that maybe they are. Most of them are really just trying to do their job. I also hear her saying they don't know the dynamics they're going to face once they get out there. And they've been trained and skilled to act, to play it out as they have to protect themselves even. Well, either one of you, what do you think about this? Any response to what the Major said? You, sir, Esquire, you're defending these people all of the time. What's your take on it? Is it just that cut and dry?
Well, no, I don't think it is that cut and dry. Mm. And the facts of each situation turns the situation, as the Major was outlining.
Right.
And
I wasn't fair when I said just that cut and dry, because she really mixed it up for us. And she really didn't make it sound like it's always that simple.
Correct. And so she outlined several facts, and I can see those facts happening.
Mm-hmm.
But there are other dynamics happening also on the defendant side,
yes.
the person who's being stopped.
Yes.
And just from growing up here in Atlanta,
mm-hmm.
Born a few days before Martin Luther King was shot and killed.
Wow.
There was a perception in my community that the police were bad.
Mm-hmm.
That when the police came around, it wasn't a positive experience. And so running from the police was deemed acceptable.
Mm-hmm.
I'm highlighting this story because
wow.
once I went to law school, as you're reading the cases in criminal procedure, one of the things that give police officers reasonable suspicion or probable cause to think something's going on is actually running.
Mm-hmm.
Where in our neighborhood, that was standard procedure.
Oh, my.
But from a police officer's perspective, that means something's going on.
We have a problem if
correct.
You run.
And so here is something from our
perspective.
That's
interesting.
And so here's something from our perspective. Whether you're doing anything wrong or not, please come around. Just gun. Just
wow.
run. Just run because you don't know. From their perspective, and again, I had to grow into this being a lawyer. From their perspective, there's a problem. Why are you running? And different parts of our society view police officers.
That's amazing to hear that. Mm-hmm. That's insight, because I am weighing on the side of the police if I see someone running. I'm thinking they're suspect, they've done something, but I'm hearing you say this was actually a part of what you're being told to do when you're growing up. This is like a teaching, if you will.
It's a cultural dynamic is what you're saying.
That's correct.
It's a cultural dynamic.
We're going to need you on the mic, Dr. Okay. Greathouse, if you would like to speak.
Either one of you can answer this. If it's a cultural dynamic, then if a black male is driving a car and he stopped, and that is the dynamic that he's familiar with, okay, what happens as the officer is approaching the car, he already has anxiety build up.
Okay. Officer or the person stopped?
The person who is being stopped based on that cultural dynamic.
Yes.
Okay. So then what happens? What becomes that person's rights? Okay. The officer stops, says, okay, I want to tell you your taillight is out. There's no reason then for the person to get out of the car. Okay. But what happens in this dynamic? The officer says, I want you to step out of the car. Is there something that the person has a right to say or do before they exit their vehicle? So you understand what I'm saying? Before the running even begins.
Before I answer that question, I want to try to parse it for you. There's a cultural dynamic, but then there's also what the law provides. And the law does not take into consideration factors as far as cultural dynamics.
Absolutely. That's my point.
That does not play a part into what the law allows or does not allow.
All right.
Now, police officers can be sensitive to that if they're aware of it. I'm not sure if they are or not. Major Dietrich would have to speak to that. I've never been in those shoes to know. And there's a lot of discretion that is given to police officers and what they can and cannot do.
Okay, so let's start there. When you say in terms of the cultural dynamics as it relates, so we've already, before the traffic stop, is you've already got a mindset that the officer now, again, with all that aside, has to kind of overcome even walking up to the car. And how is this fuel? Because instead of where we go here and we talk about days where you mistrusted the police for whatever the reasons, it's like we're taking three steps forward but four steps back. Yes, use the past to grow and develop, but there are a lot of people in this position, such as myself, that want to see the right things done, that all lives matter. That's why I said I'm not minimizing black lives or any.
I get that.
So as we're talking about that, so now you already, like I said, about that made up mind. So now you've already decided that, oh, I should run or the police are against me. If you're already there, how do I overcome that as the law enforcement officer? So now, if I ask you, and in terms of your rights, that door of respect swings both ways. Mm-hmm. Now, I say, why not do what the officer asks you to do? Mm-hmm. They are the person in authority at that time.
Yeah.
If they tell you to step out of the vehicle or whatever the case may be, if you feel like something, if they say, can I search your vehicle? If you don't want them to search your vehicle, then say that. But do we have to make it confrontational to the next step that it gets to the point you're arrested?
Yeah.
That's what happens. And I don't think we know how to effectively communicate because for that reason, cultural dynamics or whatever the case may be, but that police officer should be there fair, impartial, dealing with all people the same and not trying to be able to decipher or give you a crutch, if you will, that, oh, they're going to just do it because I'm black, or you hear these things driving while black. We've got all of these things that we have to contend with when we're actually just trying to do a job.
We've got all of these things that we've put into the atmosphere against ourselves that kind of make us targets in a way. And you would think that people would all respond respectfully to authority, but they just don't. Do black lives matter, Mr. Mullins?
Yes, they do. And I've been listening to, you know, the back and forth here. One of the things, when you talk about cultural dynamics, when you have an integrated police force, they in fact should understand some of the dynamics that come from a diverse community. If you have black officers, white officers, whatever it may be, there should be some type of interaction between fellow police officers to explain those kind of dynamics so they can understand some of the things that happen. But as you said earlier, there are some situations that are just not that simple.
I'm going to just pause you right there, Mr. Mullins. I apologize. Of course, when you started, it's time for us to take our first break. Key, hold your thought. Y'all stay with us. I know you're enjoying this conversation. Call in and join us. Stay with us until the other side of the break. We'll be right back.
The Sankofa Media Group is a mass media company that creates socially responsible, informative, and entertaining content that reaches audiences all over the world. Sankofa Media's leading-edge technology and know-how develops winners into who they were created to be. Timely radio and talent like Blog Talk Radio's Abiding the Tripartite.
God tells us in His Word we can have what we say, but we are always saying what we have. You must believe to the point of expectation and you shall receive.
In Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner.
I want to talk to the game changers. I want to talk to the ones who the game was changed on, but yet they triumphed. I want to talk to the people who provide a platform for others to change the game for themselves.
Sankofa publishes messages of love, hope, and redemption that connect with us where we need it the most.
The book, What About Me, is a story of the kind of faith and courage that engages the reader to reflect personally and spiritually, especially in these uncertain times of today. It's a great thought-provoking page-turner.
If you're ready to step out of the boat and join the Sankofa Media Group in showcasing your God-given gifts and talents, contact us today at 855-334-7316. That's 855-334-7316.
Do you need someone with solid, expert communications experience to write your copy or your next press release? Then you need PennStar Communications. Let PennStar communicate your greatest potential with clear copy written for your business and marketing needs. Whether it's your next event or next campaign, PennStar Communications can write that for you. Visit PennStar.org or call 404-828-0287 today.
Are you looking for an attorney? Or better yet, are you looking for the right results? Call the Ponder Law Group, 404-870-8070. If your case is complicated and confusing, call today. We take individual cases personally, just like your family. The Ponder Law Group, making clients into lifelong friends. Call 404-870-8070. The Ponder Law Group, if you want to win. When everyone else says no, the Ponder Law Group says yes. We're the ones to call for your legal needs. The Ponder Law Group, 404-870-8070. The hiring of an attorney is an important decision that should not be based solely upon advertising. Ask for free written information about the firm's qualifications and experience.
You loved me through my good. You loved me through my bad.
Together.
Thank you, kind sir. Thank you, kind engineer. Thank you, kind guest. It's heated in here, y'all. They could hardly stop talking during the break. We got a great subject going here, and I think that the major has told us something that we really need to hang our hats on. We really need to make this something we do. We get around the table. We use these platforms that reach the masses, and we talk about this, and we find better ways to approach it. I want to let Mr. Mullins continue his statement. Go ahead, sir.
As I was saying, is that, you know, it's all these things that come out of your culture. One of the things is that when I was a kid, I lived in the neighborhood in the city, precincts in that city, in the neighborhood, and police officers patrolled that city. They knew the residents of that city. So therefore, it was a better relationship. But this thing about I heard the major say about persons being in authority and telling you to step out of your car, whatever it may be. There are some people that feel, well, why do I have to step out of my car if I have not done anything? Now, if you walk up to me and say, you know, Mr. Mullins, your tail light is out, because you can say that coming to me and whatever it may be. Now I'm not on edge because you've already communicated to
me.
I've had my own experience. police officer walks up and says, let me see your driver's license and registration. Mm-hmm. Okay. I say, sir, what did I do? Give me your driver's license and registration. Now, I'm already getting mad. Mm-hmm. You understand? Because, see, you stopped me.
Right.
I don't think I did anything wrong, but here you are, you demanding me to give you identification, mm-hmm. but you don't want to tell me what's wrong.
Right.
So now
we've set the atmosphere for maybe something not quite so positive.
That's right.
And let's just admit it, it's not a positive thing that we're feeling is going to happen when we're getting stopped.
No.
And you said you've had your own experience. I've had my own experience. Maybe others in the studio have. I've worked with other nationalities most of my career. Their experiences don't match mine. But, you know, the major is here telling me we're not a target. Police officers are not going out targeting minorities on a daily basis. But why don't we see a balance with the other nationalities the way things are playing out? I don't know.
Well,
is there an answer for that? You and your defending of clients, do you see a balance of races, if you will, playing out? I don't know. Am I asking a complete enough question? Do you know what I'm saying here?
I think I know what you're saying, okay. And let me see if I can articulate it back to you.
Yes, sir.
That it is your belief that African-Americans have interaction with the police officers at a greater rate, than other parts of the community.
I believe that is true.
All right.
And I could be influenced by what the major is saying, because that is what the media tends to portray more. But I just don't believe the media is overlooking crimes with other nationalities just to put the spotlight on minorities.
Let me say it this way, that we don't have the facts and figures here.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I have the same belief, mm-hmm. but I'm not going to. But you know, being an attorney, you got to deal with the evidence.
Exactly.
I don't have evidence,
right,
of that.
And you're right. And I'm sitting here thinking, well, if I were going to make that point, I should have looked that up. But I decided to go rogue today and not use my notes.
Let me just say something too.
You may.
Attorney Winfrey made a comment earlier about the perception in Atlanta. Again, the police were bad, so minorities automatically would take off running. So. With that being said, if this is the case, and first of all, it's a perception that, you know, you already have because you have your beliefs based upon culturally.
Mm-hmm.
So now when we start talking about these interactions that we hear that go south so easily, again, we've already talked about the cultural dynamics that mm-hmm. face us in our own community, that sometimes we're driving some of that by our actions in and of itself, mm-hmm. which is why it becomes that news story. Mm-hmm. But in terms of law enforcement, if we already take upon the position that we are targeting and using words such as targeting, those are inflammatory words in themselves,
mm-hmm.
that starts that dialogue as well. So again, I think we need to kind of step back from some of that and think about some of the things that we can do ourselves, meaning the things that you talk about, community policing and so on and so forth, that's so important.
Mm-hmm.
But the people that are probably out here doing some of the things that we maybe don't like or not desirable are not the people that are attending those forums that we're talking
about
that need to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think we need to look at it from that standpoint. But the majority of the people that I think that are upset or outraged or feeling some type of way at this point,
mm-hmm.
I think it's because they don't quite know, and they want a solution. They want to work, and we need to figure out a way that we can communicate and work along those lines. But I do think a lot of it has to do with our perception, and I think a lot of times we do that. We've got in our criminal justice books, driving while black, riding while black, or the whole nine yards. Now, what is being said here I think is important,
yes.
but I think we need to kind of go beyond that. I think we have a lot of people, and maybe way back some time, yes, it was the law enforcement didn't look like you and I.
Mm-hmm.
But now that has changed.
Mm-hmm.
We are game changers. And
yes.
we're in positions to where, so if you had that thought process, then the thing that you talked about the questions asked, you know, why did you have to get out of your vehicle and so on and so forth, I tell people all the time, on the side of the road is not where you try to solve that issue. Mm-hmm. And what people say when they say, well, it's a code of silence, or it's not going to do you any good to report anything because the police are going to cover it up and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. Again, a negative perception. Now, I can honestly say I see complaints. I go to community meetings, and I encourage people, if you have any issue, to bring it to, and we have a process in place, because we're doing that officer a disservice and you a disservice, meaning rude and unwanted behavior. How would we know that if no one ever told us? So mm-hmm. what do? We wait for something to happen, and then we react to it, and then you paint us all with one brush.
Wow.
And that's where
what,
a problem.
And that's what really has happened in the Black community. We've been painted with one brush because of maybe what a minority in the minority is doing. You mentioned something about there are more people of color on the force now than there were in years past. I've always wondered about, and you may know this, like in my field in communications, and I learned in undergrad that depending on the population of the city, whether it was heavily Black populated or white, that would be the face of the news anchors or the people on television that they would try to put in place just to reckon themselves with the major population of the city. Why don't we see that with police officers? It seems that that would be an okay, deliberate act to me, instead of seeing places like full white police forces in full Black communities. Does that even weigh in the psyche of choosing or?
Well, and you have
exactly.
And let me just say, I can definitely speak on that, because I did recruiting again for many years, mm-hmm. and that is important. And I think your police force should represent the community, the population
yes.
that they serve. And I can say in DeKalb, we do. And that's important. In those communities that's not the case, mm-hmm. then that's when the community needs to have a voice in that, to make sure that you're in talk to the York City Council or whomever, whether it be Ferguson or whatever. But we wait until something happens, and mm-hmm. then we react the way we saw this play
yes.
out. And so I think we all have a responsibility to correct the wrongs that you see.
Mm-hmm.
Be the game changers, if you will.
Yes.
Let your voice be heard,
mm-hmm.
but not in the way that we see, well, it's lawless, you know, and
right.
we're doing those things. That's not effective. So do it something prior to. Be proactive instead of reactive.
Good.
So I need a mic.
Wait a minute.
Can I interject something?
Yes, you may.
To that.
You may.
Got a couple points.
Mm-hmm.
All police actions with the community are not running away from breaking the taillights. You understand? Or whatever it may be. You can be walking down the street and have a confrontation with the police, and you don't even understand why you're even having that confrontation.
Mm-hmm.
You see? And just like in the service, you know, I was a Marine.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody can't be a Marine.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody can't be a police officer.
That's right.
There are some police officers who do not need to be
yes,
there.
Yes, I would agree.
Is it?
Yes, I would agree.
And with that being said, if no one ever brought it to attention, like mm-hmm. I just said about that process, that you had an encounter that you felt as a citizen was you know, not appropriate, then what did you do about it other than go in and tell your next door neighbor about it?
Mm-hmm.
And then we all paint this negative perception of police officers. And let me just make one other point real quick about when you say the encounters of someone walking down the street. And I used to use things like this with criminal justice students, because I'm passionate about trying to make sure that your encounters are positive ones.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning, so we have things in the community. People don't want the homes broken into, their cars broken into. We want extra patrol. We want you to stop suspicious people. So I say to them, what is a suspicious person?
Mm-hmm.
What does a suspicious person look like?
Right.
Of course, they can't answer that question. So what do? We encourage you to call us to tell us because you know in your neighborhood what is suspicious,
mm-hmm.
correct?
So now
when I walk up to this person, they don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So that encounter, I may be responding to a call.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know that. We just
exactly.
jump to conclusions so quickly, and then we all of a sudden, we were harassed by the police. Because the other part to that is, if I'm just riding down the street and I see, you know, Mr. Winfrey here, he's walking. It's not against the law to walk down the street. But let's just say, ground and whatever the perceptions are.
That's another show, well, Major. I'm gonna get let me get the Esquire in here. Now, I know that you are criminal defense, but I don't know that this is really your area that we're talking about. But I guess you cover all crime. Tell us your perspective on some of this that's being said.
Well, that's what I wanted to do is right now we've just been talking about the facts of the circumstances, but not necessarily the legal ramifications.
Yes, sir.
And before I talk about legal ramifications, I want to echo some of the things that the major said because I've grown in my perspective. Yes. I was just trying to give a background of what the community may be facing because when I talk to a lot of my clients, they have those same thoughts.
Yes.
They still think that way. And so I have to communicate with them about that and try to get them to see this is what happened, but this is how we're going to have to defend it going forward.
This is good. I see where you're going.
And so, but I want to lay that on the ground before we start talking just purely legal.
Okay.
But I want to echo what the major said about being respectful to the police and obeying their authority because, one, it tones down the encounter.
It does.
Even if you feel that they were flat wrong in stopping you, that they were, even if you feel they targeted you in doing it, but you can have those emotions, but tone them down, be respectful. And you may be able to just, this thing just pass by with the warning that you said. I would also recommend that if a counter, like something like that happens, and you feel like you were mistreated, to write a letter and send it to the police department. I think it's internal affairs that investigation.
Yes.
And send it, and here's why, from a defense attorney's perspective.
Yes.
When we're getting ready to go to trial, a lot of times we start pulling the personnel files of the police officers who are going to be there testifying.
Right.
And if you pull a police officer file and there's nothing there, then we have nothing to hang our hat on to say that this person was picking on this particular racial group. But if every time that something happened that you felt was bad, you actually wrote a report and sent it to the police, now there's a file there from the defense attorney's perspective we can use that on this day you stopped this person.
Yes.
Now we have something in the courtroom that we can fight with. And what the major was trying to get across was that the place to defend your innocence is not on the side of the road with the police officers. Because their job is not the judge or the jury. Their job is just to, if they're going to take you in custody, take you in custody. If not, not.
Yes.
But to argue about your legal rights and to find out whether you were justified or not justified, that's for the courtroom.
See,
and depending on what you do on the side of the road will have a huge impact on what happens in the courtroom.
Absolutely.
Because I've worked out cases with police officers where they said, well, this person was respectful to me, and so I'm willing to work a deal with them even without talking to the DA. But I've also had cases where the police officer was like, he was disrespectful to me. I don't care what you say.
Wow.
I'm not doing anything for him.
Wow.
If he wants any favor, he's going to get it from the judge because he disrespected me, and because of that, I'm trying to, you know, I'm going to hold my feet.
I hear the major and the Esquire giving us power. They're giving us the keys and the tools, the strategic. They may sound simple to you. They may sound like I'm not going through all that. I'm not doing that. But they sound like strategic keys and tools to work to having effective relationships with the legal system. That's what I hear.
And again, I want to say one thing.
Mullins had something to comment. Mr. Mullins wanted to comment on.
Well, let me just throw this one last piece in there.
Reggie, and then I'm going to say something.
Let me just throw one last piece. I don't want the listeners to believe that I'm just saying this because I'm a lawyer, because I've been confronted with the same things as well. I mean, I've been stopped numerous times, even since being a lawyer by police officers. But I've taken the same advice I'm saying to tone it down. Now, the one step I have not done, which I should have done, is write the stuff up and send it in. And I got that idea because I was running by another defense attorney. He was like, dude, write it up. I'm sorry, Mr. Mullins.
Oh, no, you're fine. You're fine. You're fine. It's all good.
But what I'm saying,
we're getting it all in. We're packing it all in.
But what I'm saying is that's not the real world. It is not the real world.
It's not the real world, but it needs to be a new world.
I understand that. I mean, it's there. It's a tool, you see. But the everyday person going to work who gets stopped by
the
police,
they're not going to take the time out.
He's not going to take the time, to write a letter or whatever it may be. It may not even warrant all that. But see, but what I'm saying is that people, particularly black people now, you keep talking about individual rights.
Yep.
A lot of them don't believe they even have any rights. So when you open your mouth and say, what did you stop me for? They feel that they're exercising a right to say, what did I do wrong?
What are your thoughts? What are your thoughts along the lines of solutions or turning the situation, turning the tide on what we're seeing now play out in our society?
Well, one of the things that we have to do, as I said earlier in my general comment, there needs to be more community policing. You know, and we have a tremendous problem with young folk, and we need to have, you know, some type of input programs for young folk to do things. And part of the problem is parenting. Parenting is a real problem. And I'll make a comment. When I was 14 years old, I didn't know what 2 o'clock in the morning looked like. You see?
Yes, sir.
So therefore, you know, parents have to get involved and they have to stop defending their children that are doing bad things.
Can I just want to say one thing?
You sure
you
may.
Well said. And and we talk about it's working together, but it starts in the home. You have young people that have no respect for their own parents, so let alone police officers and so on. And that's so very important. And we talk about those same things. So it is, again, this is not just one side. It's everyone working together, starting in the home, respect, and then going forward.
Excellent. We're going to take our next and final break. We'll be right back, and then we'll let Dr. Greathouse, who says she was not getting on the air, who's been yelling through this studio. We'll be right back. Dr. Greathouse can yell here anytime.
The Sankofa Media Group is a mass media company that creates socially responsible, informative, and entertaining content that reaches audiences all over the world. Sankofa Media's leading-edge technology and know-how develops winners into who they were created to be. Timely radio and talent like Blog Talk Radio's Abiding the Tripartite.
God tells us in His Word we can have what we say, but we are always saying what we have. You must believe to the point of expectation, and you shall receive.
In Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner.
I want to talk to the game changers. I want to talk to the ones who the game was changed on, but yet they triumphed. I want to talk to the people who provide a platform for others to change the game for themselves.
Sankofa publishes messages of love, hope, and redemption that connect with us where we need it the most.
The book, What About Me, is a story of the kind of faith and courage that engages the reader to reflect personally and spiritually, especially in these uncertain times of today. It's a great thought-provoking page-turner.
If you're ready to step out of the boat and join the Sankofa Media Group in showcasing your God-given gifts and talents, contact us today at 855-334-7316. That's 855-334-7316.
Do you need someone with solid, expert communications experience to write your copy or your next press release? Then you need PennStar Communications. Let PennStar communicate your greatest potential with clear copy written for your business and marketing needs. Whether it's your next event or next campaign, PennStar Communications can write that for you. Visit PennStar.org or call 404-828-0287 today.
Are you looking for an attorney? Or better yet, are you looking for the right results? Call the Ponder Law Group, 404-870-8070. If your case is complicated and confusing, call today. We take individual cases personally, just like your family. The Ponder Law Group, making clients into lifelong friends. Call 404-870-8070. The Ponder Law Group, if you want to win. When everyone else says no, the Ponder Law Group says yes. We're the ones to call for your legal needs. The Ponder Law Group, 404-870-8070. The hiring of an attorney is an important decision that should not be based solely upon advertising. Ask for free written information about the firm's qualifications and experience.
Guys, we are back. I'm telling you, they are firing up the studio today. You know, a couple of things came up in the break. One, I want to talk about, I want someone to speak on are the rallies that we are prone to do, the rallies that we're prone to step out on, but they don't seem all too effective. And two, as we're talking about the state of the way things are, the state of affairs, if you will, the Esquire brought out a very good point. It is what it is, but he would like to inform the listening audience some before we leave on our rights and what we can do to better our individual situations, I believe. So let me hear from you all on your take on these rallies. How do you think they benefit or maybe deter from the real issues? Was that you, Dr. Greathouse? Did you want to speak on that?
Well, we'll let Mr. Mullen go first because mine is more proactive and progressive as to going forward in the future.
Yes.
And I have something for Major Dedrick concerning that. Actually, both are targeted towards you. So I'll let Mr. Mullen say what he has about the rallies that we currently see on television, you know, constantly when something goes awry. So go ahead, Mr. Mullen, and then I'll come back and ask.
What I'm saying, particularly the black community, when something goes wrong, we are prone to march. We'll march for this. We'll march for that. And then after the march, you wait 3 days, they sweep up the street, and it's business as usual.
Mm.
What we need to do, I feel that in the black community, we cannot become an entity in society if we are not viewed as a political entity.
Mm-hmm.
If we have political power, then things are a lot better. Black folks march, white folks vote.
Mm.
And so what happens is, if black folks in that rally that went across the bridge.
That's
went
a new slogan.
Or went across the street. If at the end of the rally, hey, our next march is to the registration office to vote.
Okay, Dr. Greathouse, and then we're going to let the Esquire close us out with some real pertinent information that I think the listening audience is really going to look forward to.
Okay. Major Dedrick, I was thinking when you guys had your dialogue earlier about rallies and all of that. And my thought was, everybody has rallies. The community rallies, everybody has a rally. Why not to make a presence, a positive presence in the communities, why not have the police forces call a rally? That the police call a community rally and the police spearhead it, and their agenda is to help build the community's confidence in them that they are actually there to protect and to serve them and not to kill them, beat them down, and populate our jails with them. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
Why can't we have those type of things? My second thing is I'm thinking about accountability. Why can't a ticket be devised for the ones that they don't take into custody? Why can't to hold the officer accountable when when you get a traffic stop and you get your copy of the ticket? Why can't there be a number, a 1-800 number on that ticket that Dr. Greathouse can call and say, officer badge number so-and-so treated me like I was a human being, or he was so or she was so disrespectful? Why can't there be a number that we can call to report, you follow me?
Yes.
Any adverse behavior. Because if the officer realizes, okay, I'm going up to this car, if I have to give a ticket, there's an 800 number on there that person is able to call immediately. So they don't have to write something for the attorney to go to court.
Well, as she said, those are kind of progressive ideas, if you will. And I think you all are in the community all of the time, but not paralleling what we do in the marches. What are your thoughts on that?
And you're absolutely right. We are. We have, and I can tell you, community meetings all of the time where people want to be a part of that and do some positive things. But, you know, I think we're in a climate right now that the rallies and the marches and all those things to dramatize it, I think that is what seems to sell the sexy story, if you will, and as opposed to those people that are really wanting to come out here for something positive. Sometimes it seems like the bad want to outweigh the good. Now, when you start talking, because we do that, community meetings, that is why probably, but you have not seen, and I don't want to jinx myself in the cap, but because those community relations are building in a positive way because we do these things, that you probably don't see some of the things that you've mm-hmm. seen in other places within the country. Now, to the point relative to the back of the ticket, a 1-800 and a number, then let me just tell you what we do, and we encourage them to call because, you know, DeKalb is large, even anywhere where those tickets are issued for like the state as it mm-hmm. relates and imprinted and so on and so forth. So what happens is you have that information for that precinct or you can find that officer if you really wanted to say A, something good, or you wanted to make a complaint. So you sure. don't have to necessarily write a letter. Yep. We want to hear the good as well because we're going to take that same complaint the same because I say this passionately. We want to know. You said there's no profession where everything is perfect where we do it right all the time. Mm-hmm. I'd like to think that's that right. officers' intent would be good and everything is within good faith and the whole nine yards. But will they get it wrong sometimes? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Then as a community, do your part and to help us kind of correct that going mm-hmm. forward as opposed to just, again, painting us with one brush and then just thinking, all law enforcement are doing something they shouldn't do.
That's good. That's good. Esquire, go ahead and tell the listening audience before we close today where they can find you if they are in need of your services and however you want, whatever you would like to contribute.
Well, first off, I would like to say that we've been talking so far about a traffic stop mm-hmm. as opposed to other interactions with the police officer. Mm-hmm. And when the police officer comes in, I'm going to still deal with the traffic stop, and they ask for your license, your registration, you have to give it to them. Mm-hmm. That is required. If you don't, that's a charge in and of itself.
Yes, correct.
And so I want to encourage people to make sure they do that. Mm-hmm. Because I've had clients that didn't want to do that.
Yes.
And because they didn't, it escalated yes. the matter.
I think we see that a lot.
And so, and again, be respectful.
Yes.
Give those things. Now, if they ask to search your car, you have a right to say no.
Mm-hmm.
Now, police officers will ask, and this is in their purview to ask. Even whether they have probable cause or not.
Right.
And if you say yes, they can search it, they don't need probable cause because you've given them permission yes. to search.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But you have the authority to say no
mm-hmm.
and require them to go get probable cause and go get a search warrant.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's say that the police.
What is probable cause? Could they say, I think I smell marijuana?
That's another joke.
We'll be here all day.
Okay.
We'll be here all day talking about probable cause because I'm sure the major has one definition.
Okay, yeah.
I'm a defense attorney.
Yeah.
I have a totally right. different definition.
There we go.
But that's what we fight about in the courtroom.
But therein lies the rub.
Correct.
They could find probable cause right there on the spot to search, couldn't they?
Well, if you say no, mm-hmm. you give me something to argue.
Mm-hmm.
If you say yes, they can search your car, you give me nothing to work with.
Got it.
If you say no, you cannot search my car, mm-hmm. and the police officer said, I don't care. I'm going to search it anyway.
Oh.
I now have something to fight with.
Mm-hmm.
I have something to fight with now. Because while the police officer may think they have probable cause, the person who ultimately determines that
mm-hmm.
is the judge.
Got it.
And I can call that police officer mm-hmm. to the courtroom and have that police officer explain in a courtroom how they got there.
Mm.
And even if their process of getting to the probable cause was illegal, we can win it still.
Got it.
And there are a lot of ways to win it, but you have to give the defense attorney something to work with by saying, no, you cannot search my car.
Well, the people you're defending, you really believe, you have to believe, or you take on the charge to believe that they are innocent. Do you see a lot of repeat offenders in your line of work?
Let me back up on your question.
Got it.
Because I think it'll be a more impactful answer.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of my clients are guilty.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Because these issues do not get to the courtroom when people are innocent. They only get to the courtroom when people are guilty.
Mm.
But you have to be vigilant in fighting for the rights of the guilty in order to protect the innocent.
Wow.
If you're unwilling to protect the rights of the guilty, you also refuse to protect the rights of the innocent.
That's absolutely correct.
That's excellent, Esquire.
And so a lot of times, I mean, my clients, a lot of them, I should say, they're not necessarily guilty of the police. Say they're guilty of something, but you know, and the police are trying to figure it out.
And then they take off running.
Yeah.
So the other thing is,
I don't know that I remember hearing a lawyer admit that. So that's very good. But, and the way that you explain it is impactful.
And one of the things I discovered while I was in law school and in the practice of law, if the police officers do their job right, there's very little that I can do.
And can I just
And so that's what you're looking for. You're looking for those loopholes. You're looking for that mishandling of that case or that
interaction. Correct. And I don't mean to be disrespectful, but it happens all the time. Wow.
And let me just chime in on that, having been and you learn from those mistakes, because again, you want to make a good case, but it is his job to find out, you know, if you didn't do something quite right. And that's where we should have that relationship. That's our criminal justice system as it relates, because the rights, we're here to protect and serve, and all of that works together.
Yes.
So again, if that's going to make me better as an officer, if I'm doing my job right, and I didn't do something by the book, but I'd like to think that we're doing, and we've got to change the perception, not thinking that an officer is going to pull you over and plant a weapon on you or some drugs or whatever misconceptions that are out there. We need to change that and work together effectively, knowing that we're all here for the greater good.
But I think we admit that there is a small minority of officers who do that. I mean, our life is on camera now. We're seeing it play out on camera in front of us.
And let me just say that if that would be the case, and let's just say if it's the Attorney Winfrey here, and you find that you have an officer, let's just say, for instance, I think your bio, you had a lot to do with drugs and so on and so forth. Then if for some reason, and usually in a drug unit, those detectives or whatever are in there for a while, so you probably would see some of the same people. Now, if you have a detective or whatever that's constantly doing some things that you feel are, you know, not quite right, then just instead of just winning that case, what about where is your responsibility as it relates to that letter writing? Just look at it, because, again, you may be that sharp attorney that gets that person off. But what about that new attorney that comes out of the law school who's not as sharp as you? And then we have a person that maybe is in jail, innocent person is in jail, if that's the case. If we feel so strongly that an officer is out here, if you really feel that that is the case, then what do you do to correct that?
Final thoughts, Esquire?
Well, I do think that defense attorneys need to, on our end, to write those letters and do those things and to document those files. And when I think about doing it, I think about doing it more so from the aspect of the courtroom. Because ultimately, these things that happen in the street, justice plays out in the courtroom and how the things happen. And if you don't have documentation of it, from where I sit, no one believes my client. So my client can't go in the courtroom and say these things happen. They can say it, but they're going to need other pieces to add to it. That's what these letters and other things, pieces, add to it. And so it's a difficult job. It's a rewarding job. But it needs help. It needs help on a lot of different sides. But if people have any more questions, they can come check me out on my website at www.epwpc.com.
Excellent. Mr. Mullins, anything in closing?
Well, I didn't get in all the things that I wanted to say.
Mr. Mullins, that means you'll just have to come back.
We got very passionate about what we were talking about.
We did.
And we swayed and swayed. But
I think we got some good stuff
in. I do, and I appreciate being here. But I would like for you to give me an opportunity to come back.
Yes, sir. I certainly will. Anything in closing, Dr. Greathouse?
No, I'm fine. Okay. I'll let Major Dedrick have her final words.
Major.
Well, first, let me say, I do think discussions like this, dialogue, is so important, just like we have a defense attorney, and I welcome things like this, and I think we need to do more of them. I think that as a community, we need to kind of do some things to solutions that are effective, that affect all of us. And when I say that, and I'm going to say all lives, black lives, all lives matter, even the suspect, if you will, all lives matter. And I think that's important. So, again, I think we just need to continue to communicate and have this type open dialogue, a healthy discussion.
I think I heard that from everybody here today, guys. If you were listening like I was listening, I heard that all lives matter. I heard that the power is within us. The power is in our hands. Each of our guests gave us a tool, a way to make a difference. Mr. Mullins said that black lives matter, or black people rally and white people vote. The major told us to Get out there and make a difference. Have more discussions and involve your community and stop waiting until we see the media cry and the rallies and all of that good stuff. The lawyer gave us the 1, 2, 3 on how to stay straight, how to keep it clean, and how not to end up in trouble this way. But he also told us that when you do, he's there. He's there. He can defend you. Right or wrong. I love it. I love it. But he's doing it for the right cause. He's doing it for the ultimate end. And that reminds me of the reason that our Constitution was created. It was created for the ultimate end goal, so that everyone would end up on the same playing field with the same rights that we hold today as American citizens and as game changers. I will talk to you in 6:23. That's 6 days and 23 hours. Until then, do your best.
Thank you for listening to Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner. For more details about anything discussed on the program, go online to www.penstar.org. That's PENSTAR.org. And be sure to follow Lisa on social media. On Facebook, look for Lisa M. Faulkner and follow Penn Star Lisa on Twitter and Instagram. And join us every week at this same time for Game Changers with Lisa Faulkner right here on Love 860 WAEC, Atlanta's inspirational talk radio.
Tune in.
Now.
You can tune into this radio station on any smartphone or tablet.
iPhone.
Android.
BlackBerry.
Nokia.
Samsung.
Windows phones.
Or whatever you have. Download the free TuneIn app from your phone or tablet's app store.
Tune in with music, sports, news, and comedy.
From over 70,000 radio stations around the world, including this Beasley Broadcast Group station. Check it out at TuneIn.com.
Or your app store.